Well, hello, and a big welcome to this Church Without Walls service streamed on behalf of All Saints in Otbrook and St Stephen's in Borrowash. It's great to be connected with you again, wherever you are, and thank you so much for watching. It's with sadness that I bring the news of the recent death of a former vicar in the parish, the Reverend Edmund Haviland. Edmund was here in the 1950s. He later retired to Salisbury, where he died earlier this week, aged 96. We thank God for Edmund's ministry here in the parish, and we send our condolences, our thoughts and prayers to Edmund's family at this time. We're now including a community corner slot in these services. This is opportunity for anyone who regularly watches to send in short video clips acknowledging birthdays, anniversaries, special celebrations, and also just letting us know how you're doing. If you'd like to do that, you send them to Moira, and the address for that will be on the screen at the end of the service. And now let us pray. Loving Father God, we thank you that your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. May we know the guiding light of your word in these dark times, we pray. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from Colossians chapter 3, beginning to read at verse 12. And is taken from the New International Version. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord.
I was watching TV earlier this week and started to notice how many adverts there are out there for self-improvement, whether via fitness training or ways of eating sensibly, each of which supposedly is there to help us improve ourselves, our lives, our ways of living, and our ways of thinking. But then I started to wonder how many adverts are out there to help us improve our inner selves, our spiritual selves, our innermost beings. I then read our reading for today and the words, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly," really came out to me very strongly. Let me say them again. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. We live in a world today that in a lot of ways values that highly which is around us. The things we are aware, the things we have, the latest kitchen we have. But really, are these things important in the grand scheme of things? And today, I would like to challenge you to say no. Okay, it's all right to have them. And yes, I like to have nice clothes, a nice copy from a well-known copy provider. But do these things really change and challenge who I am inside? No, again, I would say. That is why we need to feed ourselves spiritually as well. As our writer to the church in Colossae says, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in wisdom, and with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. So I wonder, how many people here can answer a couple of questions about ourselves and our bodies? Question 1. How long can a body live without food? Question 2. How long can a body live without water? Okay, so what are the answers? How long can a body live without food? Medical people say about 8 to 21 days, or up to 2 months if there is adequate water present. And question 2. As a rule of thumb, how long can a body live without water? About 3 days. But surely we should be asking a much more important question. How long can we exist without being spiritually fed? And to appropriate our Bible reading, we need to let the Word of God dwell in us richly. So my next question, how can we do this? Well, as our theme for today is the Bible, maybe we already have a solution to this question. I want to challenge everybody present here, and yes, I include myself within this group. We need to regularly read and discern what the Bible is saying to each of us, in our lives, and as a community here as well. We need to listen to what God is saying to us, challenging us to do, and be willing to be changed by what we hear as well, which of course may be the more difficult thing to do and receive. But firstly, let's look at this book. It comes in many and different sizes, editions, languages, forms, and I particularly like some of the more avant-garde versions, whether that's the Bible in Cockney, or the Lego Bible, or the Harry Potter Bible. But what is the same in every version is the same story that starts with God creating our world and us in it, especially the book of Genesis. Then moving through the life and times, laws and rules, songs, hymns and psalms and history of the people of Israel and Judah throughout the Old Testament, with some very interesting episodes, including spotted and striped cattle that lead on to how zebras got their stripes, or Jael murdering with a tent peg, Judges, and Baal's talking donkey or ass, Numbers. We then start to read the New Testament, where we see the story of how God had to send his own son down on here to save us from ourselves, from the world we live in and the values we thought were important, the things we have, i.e. false gods, false values, and mammon and the love of things. I wonder, does that remind you of where and how I started this talk today? We then have the writings and history of the early Christian church, Acts and the writings of Paul and others. And then to finish off, we have the Apocalypse book in the New Testament, the Revelation of John, which some theologians have called the writings of St. John on speed. So then perhaps you may want to ask me, how should we read our Bibles then? Well, I don't have enough time here and now to answer that question. But what I will say is that there are hundreds of different ways of doing this, whether using Bible reading notes, or apps on your telephone, or PC if possible, or joining groups here at church, such as our own growth groups. Ask those around you, your friends and neighbours perhaps, they can recommend ways to do this, outside the church building, please because of COVID requirements. Or if you'd like to find out more, please contact us at church. What I do want to emphasise isn't something we need to do not every only Sunday, it's something we need to action every single day of our lives. So as we read our Bibles, we can see God working through our own history and through our lives here today and now. We can use the Bible to strengthen our faith and knowledge to be able to share it with others around us and see how God speaks to us and challenges us, and ultimately how we can be changed and those around us can be changed by having knowledge of a God who says, let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. Let it teach and admonish us in wisdom, and with gratitude in our hearts, let us sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. Amen.
Oh, good morning, everybody. I hope you're all okay. I'm sorry you've got to see me like this in my dressing gown and towel. I'm running really late. I just can't decide what to wear for church this morning. I just don't know what to put on. Oh, dear, I'm really at a loss. I mean, do you think I should wear this?
Well,
it is my favourite colour. And, yeah, I love blue and it's a nice cardigan. But it's a bit dirty. So what about, what do you think? Is this better for church? Well, I just don't know. Maybe it's a bit itchy and big and maybe I'll be too hot. So what about, maybe I'll wear this hat. I just can't decide. What do you think? Right, that's it. I've decided. I'm going to wear this. I love the colour. Pink's one of my favourites. It's nice and comfy. No holes in it. And even better, it's clean. One of the first decisions that you and I have to make every single day is the decision about what we're going to wear. I suppose it depends on what we're going to be doing that day and where we're going. But lots of the time, we might want to wear an outfit that looks nice. It's in style. Some people might even want to wear clothes that have got a particular brand to them. What's important to a lot of us is that they're in good condition, that they've not got holes in them or buttons missing, and most of all, that they're clean. As you are choosing every day about what to wear, do you ever give a thought about what the Bible might say we should wear? Well, the Bible doesn't tell us that we should wear a pink jumper or blue shoes or brown trousers or a particular hat. No, the Bible doesn't say that. But the Bible does say that as children of God, we should clothe ourselves in a certain way. The Bible says we should clothe ourselves with kindness, gentleness, and patience. It says we should then put on a forgiving attitude. Finally, the Bible says we should top it all off with love. The great thing about the outfit that the Bible describes is that it fits all of us, girl and boy, young and old. And even greater news than that, it never goes out of style. So, the next time you're getting ready to go out, wherever that might be, maybe you're off to a party, or maybe going to school, or a friend's house. Whatever you're doing, maybe think about putting on a little bit of patience, a little bit of kindness, a little bit of gentleness. Add some forgiveness, and then top it all off with love. Shall we say a prayer? Dear Father, we are always careful in choosing what clothes to wear. Help us to be careful choosing our attitudes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thanks for joining me again this week, guys. I hope you all have a great week. And if you're on half term, I do hope you have lots of fun. Take care. See you really soon.
In our prayers today, we put all thoughts and worries, hopes and dreams into the hands of God. We place into the hands of God our families, our homes, the life of our churches and our communities, the people around us, those we meet, and those who we long to be with. we place into the hands of God a world that needs peace, a world that needs wisdom, a world that needs healing. We place into the hands of God all who translate the Bible, all who distribute your word across the globe, and we are grateful for those who shared the Bible with us. We place into the hands of God the leaders of every nation, the poor of our own and every land, those who live in fear, and all who hold the lives of others in their hands. We place into the hands of God all who are working in frontline employment, those who are in laboratories processing tests and searching for a vaccine. We rest our hope in you alone, Lord. We place into the hands of God all those who need to be reminded of your nearness. All who are waiting for test results, all struggling with their health, and all who are concerned for the well-being of loved ones. We place into the hands of God all who have lost businesses and employment, all who have lost homes and livelihoods. Lastly, we place into the hands of God ourselves, each with our own needs, and may we rest these in your loving hands today. Renew in us a deeper sense of who we are in you. Help us to be aware of your presence each and every day. And may our words, actions, and lives be living examples of your forgiving, healing, life-giving love. Amen. Thank you.
The best thing that I like about Rise and Shine is reminding in Jesus.
Anything else?
Well, there's colouring about Jesus and... I know. The best thing about Rise and Shine is believing in God.
About making.
You like making things?
Yeah.
What else do you like?
I like drawing things and eating stuff.
And eating things? And do you learn about Jesus?
Yeah.
Do you enjoy that?
Playing and listening and playing or not.
Well, in a few moments, this Church Without Wall service will conclude with a prayer of blessing. Before that, just one or two things to say. Firstly, thank you to all those involved in the service today and to Moira, our editor, who has put the service together. A little bit later on today, Moira is going to receive the Bishop's badge in a service on Zoom from Derby Cathedral. And she's receiving the badge for services to the church this year. So I'd like to congratulate Moira again, and I'm looking forward to joining you a bit later, Moira, for that service. We've organised a 24-hour day of prayer for our churches here in the parish from 10 a.m. on Saturday, October the 31st, to 10 a.m. on Sunday, November the 1st. Lecky is organising the day. It will commence with a Zoom prayer meeting, which I'm going to host. If you'd like to be part of that, if you'd email me, please, and then I'll invite you. My email address will be on the screen at the end of the service. There'll be times during the Saturday when All Saints Church in Otbrook is open for private prayer or small gatherings of not more than 6 people. You may also like to organise a prayer walk around the community if you wish. It would be really good, Lecky says, if people could sign up to pray for a period of either half an hour or an hour throughout the 24-hour period. If you'd like to use the church website to do that, that would be really helpful. The theme for the day is praying in the light, and there'll be Bible verses and thoughts around that theme on the website and on the prayer WhatsApp in due course. Well, until we meet again, I hope you and your families remain safe and well. And now a prayer of blessing. Loving God, may we all be nourished deeply by your word, and may we know its light guiding us in your way at this time. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen.